Welcome to CB8 Speaks, a monthly program about issues relevant to Community Board 8. Community Board 8 covers the Upper East Side from 59th Street to 96th Street, from the 5th Avenue to the East River, including Roosevelt Island and Central Park. My name is Cos Spagnoletti, First Vice Chair of Community Board 8 and tonight's host. Our topic today concentrates on Community Board 8 District. However, it is relevant to all of New York City. Our guest today is Caroline Bragdon. She's from New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. Welcome, Caroline.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Rather than me reading your bio, which you would have given me anyway, let's hear from you on what you do and what you intend to do. Tell us about today's topic.
Sure. I'm the Director of Neighborhood Interventions for Pest Control Services at the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. I've been with the Health Department since 2001, working on a variety of environmental health topics and concerns. I got my start really looking about pesticide use in the urban environment and learning about how much pesticides are used. From there, I became very interested in most New Yorkers' favorite pest, which is the Norway rat. And now most of what I do is both studying the patterns of the presence of rats throughout New York City. I try to use data to understand where rats are living, what characteristics of the built environment that rats are most attracted to. And then I work with a team to design programs that really address rat activity in neighborhoods. And we work with different community groups and many community boards to come up with solutions for local problems.
What are people's reaction when you tell them what you do?
Every New Yorker has a good rat story, and so I think, you know, mostly, you know, people are a little horrified, a little fascinated, and they like to share their own experiences with rats.
What are you currently doing that hopefully one day we will live in a rodent-free, or can we say rodent-free or rat-free society?
I think that we can definitely reduce the presence of rats to the point where they're not such a nuisance to neighborhoods, to buildings. What we know about rats is that they are highly preventable. And while we may never completely eliminate the Norway rat from New York City, we can certainly reduce infestations. We have a program called Attacking Rat Reservoirs, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about our Attacking Rat Reservoir program in the Upper East Side. First of all, a lot of people are curious, you know, what is a rat reservoir? What does that mean? What a rat reservoir is to us at the Health Department is a harborage environment, an environment that promotes large numbers of rats. And so this could be characteristics of the environment on a city block, on a typical urban block. And the environment of the rat includes things like your sewers, your parks, green streets, street trees, sidewalks, and then other kinds of large properties. So you may have a large multifamily building that may itself be a rat reservoir. But what is always true about rat reservoirs, the way that we define them, is that they're impacting the entire block, and the situation is chronic. And despite property owners' efforts to, say, control rats, manage rats, address rats, they keep returning. And this program, Attacking Rat Reservoirs, which was funded by our mayor, is really an effort to try to get at what are the underlying causes that makes the population keep reinfesting a neighborhood. What our staff do is they go out and they assess blocks. They do what we call a block survey. We also do park surveys and subway surveys. And they look at the conditions that are both conducive to rats, but also that are indicators of the presence of rats. So for example, we study catch basins. Catch basins collect water, right, and lead down into the sewer, but they also may have be harborage points for rats. So you can see from the slide, you'll see cracks and holes the size of a quarter or greater that are basically allowing rats to freely travel either right into the curb or right down into the catch basin. And what we don't know is whether rats use the whole sewer system. What we do know is that they may use just that subsurface as a place to harbor. And people drop litter. Sometimes you may have grease spills or leaking litter baskets, and it's a great place for rats to live because they get automatic food. We also look at tree pits. So rats' preferred place to nest is in fresh, healthy soil. So a lot of tree pits don't have fresh, healthy soil, but those that do, you may see nests beginning to develop. So when we're surveying a block, we'll count the nests. And we'll look at what are the conditions around that tree well that's attracting the rats. And usually it's a building or a business that's piling up a lot of garbage right on the tree or adjacent to the tree. We look at hollow sidewalks, so what we call sidewalk burrows. So a burrow is a nest, and sometimes a rat will take a broken down sidewalk, they'll go down and they'll build their nest in the hollow void underneath the sidewalk. And they're very simple solutions to these problems, but if a property owner doesn't know or realize, or if a business doesn't know, they can't take the steps to follow up. We assess garbage containers throughout the city. And we spend a lot of time looking at garbage containers. Are they rat resistant? Are they being maintained in a way that would attract or feed large colonies of rats? When we find those situations where garbage is not being maintained, we track that. We try to notify property owners, and we make notes of it, because until these situations are resolved, again, rats are going to keep coming back. We're training them that locations that have excessive exposed garbage are great places to come and feed. So what we do is, when we find these conditions, and we're constantly surveying the blocks and also doing individual property level inspections, when we find these conditions on a property, we identify the property owner. We look at who's paying the taxes for that place. And then we send them an order to abate. So we send an order and we attach the inspection, and we send them an order. We say, you know, we found these conditions, and you have basically 5 days to take action. And we usually give them much longer than that. We also send out letters saying we have a case manager. You know, she is available to guide property owners on the steps they should take. Some owners really know what they need to do, and some don't. So we're there to coach those owners on what they need to do. If they fail to take any kind of steps to remediate, we go back, we do repeat inspections, and issue violations. If they take steps to remediate, we close out the case, and we're happy.
And do you find that many are closed out?
Remediation depends on the neighborhood. In this neighborhood, I know that you know, over 60 to 70% of the time, the owners take action. I think it's just about 33% of owners that where we have to go follow up and issue a violation. So sometimes the owner, you know, really intends to do the right thing, but they just don't understand what they need to do. And that's where we come in and help. We offer a training program called the Rat Academy, which is free to property owners and their staff, where we walk them through first what we do when we're inspecting, and then secondly, what we want them to do in response to our inspections. So for example, we often identify in brownstone properties, they'll have stairs, and underneath and around the stairs, there may be garbage storage areas. Typically, on the Upper West Side and on the Upper East Side, what we're finding is rat activity in and around these stairs because garbage is piling up. Again, the rats are attracted. And if anything is broken down, if they can get any kind of an edge, they may start to build a nest. Owners, I find, are often not realizing that this is happening on their own front stoop. So sometimes it takes what we call a walkthrough, where the case manager or the inspector meets them on site to talk them through what we're seeing and how to fix it. And the fix could be as simple as getting some concrete and just sealing up the holes.
So what's the smallest size hole that a rat can go through?
A quarter. And a mouse only needs a hole the size of a dime.
Wow.
So if you look at examples, one thing we see frequently are non-rodent-proof doors and windows, especially at the basement level. In many buildings, you have a very hot boiler room, and they'll try to ventilate and by opening up windows or by opening up doors. Rats will then take advantage of those gaps and holes to gain entry into the property. We don't want to ever to see rats on the interior of a property. That is in a 100% preventable situation, right? Rats on the interior. But it is also 100% the responsibility of the property owner or manager to make sure that's not happening.
What about restaurants? Do you find them much more in violation?
We don't inspect the interior of restaurants. We have a separate program called our food safety program, and they do inspections with restaurants. They also offer a lot of training for restaurants. But we do look at the exterior. And what we will find on occasion is that there are garbage spaces that are not being properly cleaned. And that really is about grease and food debris being left behind, especially when you're putting it out for pickup.
So
that is a condition that we have noted,
and
we are often asking for cleanup.
If the restaurant does that, who issues the violation?
It's very confusing. So we are looking at the building as a whole, the premise. So if a restaurant is leasing space from a building, then the owner is addressed by our inspections. The restaurant itself is addressed by food safety. And sometimes we need to coordinate, and we will and can, you know, work with a community board to say, we need help with this restaurant. What we also do frequently is if there's a business improvement district or a merchants association, first of all, we can do a rat academy with a merchants association or a BID and bring all the businesses in and do the coaching that way, or we can reach out through the BID, and we'll often do that.
Now, speaking of the Rat Academy, you are coming to Community Board 8 May 11th. So we want as many people there as possible. So to all the viewers, please come.
When a community board or any kind of a community host comes together to get the community involved, definitely the impact of our program is greater when neighbors get together and work with us. And for the cleanup, in neighborhoods, the more people who come and engage and pay attention, and even if they're not property owners or business owners, even if they're residents who just care and want to push their management companies to do the right thing, what we see is that activism really plays out to reduce rat activity for the block.
So it pays to be proactive rather than reactive.
Absolutely. I mean, rats will take advantage of us being neglectful of our spaces.
We used to go down to the subway, and my wife always looks on the tracks for rats. Now, we haven't seen one for quite a while. You're taking the sport away from us.
Well, truly, the credit goes to MTA for the work that they're doing. But part of our initiatives here in attacking rat reservoirs is a lot of interagency coordination. And that comes the consulting that we do with property owners, we also do with other city agency. The MTA, the Parks Department, Department of Ed, we offer training, consultations, case management with all those agencies. And one thing that we have really done with the MTA is push that cleanup.
What about your children? What? How do they react?
I have a five-year-old and a one-year-old. So the one-year-old, he slept through a couple of different community presentations that I've done. He's not so aware, but my five-year-old can find rats in any city block. He's done a bunch of walkthroughs, and he knows how to identify a rat's nest and signs of rat activity. He's a good little inspector.
At the end of the day, are you finding that you're happy with what is being done, what the city is doing, what you're doing, what the people are doing, the public, the restaurants, the buildings, everybody involved?
Absolutely. When we're able to engage with a neighborhood, we really see the results. you know, it's not rapid. Mm-hmm. I mean, rats take a long time to infest, mm-hmm. you know, seriously infest a neighborhood. Mm-hmm. And many of these neighborhoods do have chronic problems. Mm-hmm. But when we see that organized effort, first of all, it's really fun mm-hmm. Working with communities. And then second of all, we do see the impact. Sure. And in almost every one of the neighborhoods that we've launched, we've seen an impact within a year of launch.
Good.
I think that the challenge for us with these highly mobile neighborhoods is sustaining the mm-hmm. impact.
Yes.
And for that, you know, we really need the veteran New Yorkers mm-hmm. who, you know, aren't leaving their neighborhoods to keep working with us and to be the eyes and ears
yes,
of that neighborhood, because it's the vigilance mm-hmm. That will result in a sustained difference.
Do rats perform a useful function in any way?
We would love to eliminate rats. They, mm-hmm. There are no functions. I mean, one could possibly say that the increase in predatory birds mm-hmm. like hawks, the red-tailed hawk that so many of us love,
right.
Could be related to the fact that rats are present mm-hmm. in our environment. But I actually don't think that there's mm-hmm. any real benefit to having rats mm. in our urban spaces. Mm-hmm. And even if we could just reduce them down to what would be a natural population, the point where we are now is the neighborhoods that are feeling mm-hmm. The infestation, that's really the point where they've become a pest mm-hmm. and not just an animal that lives in an urban environment. You know, rats are fluid. Mm-hmm. So what we know about rats is that we tend to find them in densely populated neighborhoods.
New York City.
The more humans, the mm-hmm. more rats. So where we don't see rats are in neighborhoods like Staten Island, where you have more single family homes, mm-hmm. or outer Queens, mm-hmm. outer Brooklyn, more single family. Rats we find a lot around multifamily buildings. And again, these are buildings that may have hundreds of apartments mm-hmm. pushing large amounts of garbage.
Which is New York City.
Exactly. You mentioned restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
Dense neighborhoods with a lot of restaurants, mm-hmm. same thing. Mm-hmm. It's the presence of the food waste mm-hmm. that's attracting rats.
Okay. Now, recently there's been articles, large-scale pest control pest, which knocks out rats into early menopause.
We have a research team that is constantly evaluating new products.
Right.
And every year there's mm-hmm. there's a different product that, you know, comes out on
right.
the market. And what we do is we don't, you know, weigh in or endorse any mm-hmm. products, but we like to evaluate anything for mm-hmm. our own use. So at this time, no one in New York City is using this product. But we will be evaluating it the way that we would any other product.
Now, Central Park, I haven't seen any rats there at all. What have you done?
Actually, again, it's not us. It's the Central Park Conservancy.
Involved.
Yes, and their Central Park Conservancy sits on you know, our interagency pest management committee, mm-hmm. and they have a very well developed integrated pest management plan mm-hmm. To address rodents and other pests. Their staff is very well trained in rodent
Good.
Management. You know, I mentioned where we're collecting a lot of information. We're mm-hmm. doing block surveys and we're doing property level inspections. These blocks were chosen specifically because of those conditions
Good.
That I had walked you through earlier. And if you flip through to the map, you can see, you know, we have about 75 blocks in this rat reservoir. And when we did our first round of mm-hmm. inspections, we had about an 18% failure rate.
Mm-hmm.
A year from now, I hope we're going to be coming back and really saying, you know, that we are seeing significant decreases. In the other neighborhoods that we launched, mm-hmm. you know, 2 years ago and then and have been working on, we're seeing, you know, 35%, 50% declines in rat activity. And I hope mm-hmm. that we're going to see the same in Community
yeah,
Board
yeah,
8.
Good. Any way we can help in getting the word out?
Yes. So definitely hosting the Rat Academy is
good.
A huge help. Recruiting Community Board 8 residents, owners, staff, mm-hmm. businesses into the academy so they know about us. you know, I spoke about our case manager, Catherine. She's a very skilled inspector. She is available to coach owners that feel that they need help. Mm-hmm. We also can continuously offer trainings. Mm-hmm. If the demand is there, we will meet mm-hmm. the community where Good. They are. And I can tailor my workshops to match the audience. I can do one just for food service mm-hmm. related businesses. I can do ones just for multifamily buildings, for green parks mm-hmm. stewards mm-hmm. and community gardeners. So, I'm really interested in working with whoever wants good. To work with us. It is good to see a community board with very active mm-hmm. residents. So our case manager, Catherine, has been hearing from people and doing a lot of walkthroughs. Good. We also, have been focusing on some of the parks because mm-hmm. it's an area of concern for many residents. They spend time in their parks. Mm-hmm. Parks are really vulnerable to rats because of the foot traffic Correct. And because of the soil, mm-hmm. right? Because rats are attracted to the soil yes. itself. So we are very closely monitoring many of the parks on mm-hmm. the Upper East Side. We do monthly counts of every nest, good. And then we go and treat all mm-hmm. of them, and then we basically graph them, which you can see. I have a burrow graph shows the decreasing burrow counts in many of the parks. You always see a seasonal increase, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. As the warmer months come, mm-hmm. Rats start to reproduce at much higher right. rates. But hopefully with our continued treatment and intervention, we will continue to see an overall trend down.
So what happens in a year's time when you've successfully eradicated most of them?
What we often do is we rezone. Mm. So we may have a huge amount of success on some blocks, mm-hmm. and there are other blocks that may need some extra help.
Good.
So what we'll often do is if we start with 75 blocks, mm. as we did here, we may pare it down to 15 that really have problems that need more time.
So what's the difference between a rat and a mouse?
The biggest difference is that the Norway rat likes to live outdoors. That's their natural habitat, right? And they okay. like to build their nests in fresh, healthy soil. The house mouse, which is your predominant species mm-hmm. of mouse, tends to be an interior-dwelling animal. Mm-hmm. So you will tend to find mice infesting the interior of structures. Mm-hmm. Mice are highly prevalent in New York, mm-hmm. just like rats, but we tend to find them on the inside. Now, when we have a really warm urban environment, yes. you may start to also see mice on the outside as well.
Oh.
And when you have infrastructure and buildings mm-hmm. that's really broken down, really, like I said, buildings mm-hmm. with a lot of holes and cracks where rats mm-hmm. can gain entry, you may start to find rats on the interior. But they are two different species. Mm-hmm. And people shouldn't think that a mouse is a baby rat. You can tell them apart. And really, the best help is vigilant around cleanliness and repair mm-hmm. of broken infrastructure. And a lot of that is the coordination mm-hmm. between city agencies.
Okay.
So, the district service cabinet meeting where mm-hmm. A district manager says to different agencies, we need you to do this and you to do that. It's very, very useful for us. So sometimes mm-hmm. we do have that broken infrastructure that just needs repair. Mm-hmm. And the community board can advocate for that repair to be expedited. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you need new trash cans in a park. The
yes.
community board can make those recommendations, sometimes allocate funding.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely the presence of a community board that really tracks what's happening mm-hmm. Helps us. And we go frequently and ask yes. For that level of coordination.
And what about council members?
Council member that wants to, say, host a rat academy mm-hmm. or invite us mm-hmm. to lead a community walkthrough where we bring together maybe groups that may be doing some finger pointing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I frequently mm-hmm. will take groups out on a walkthrough where, say, a building manager is blaming a business or they're blaming the parks. And we just try to very diplomatically coordinate so that everyone can do their part.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we always say is everyone has a role in rat control.
That's right. What about schools?
Schools, as you may have noticed, they feed a lot of children.
Correct.
And it's important that they feed a lot of children. Mm-hmm. So many schools have breakfast, lunch, snacks, and that's a lot of food waste. For anyone who has a child, you know, they eat about a third of what is served to them, and that food waste can sometimes end up on the curb for rats to feed. What we've been doing is we've been working with Department of Ed and Department of Sanitation to help encourage schools to participate in the organic waste recycling program, where they take food waste and the children do it themselves in their cafeterias, and they put the food waste in these brown bins, which is then picked up directly by Department of Sanitation and brought to compost facilities. So they actually are recycling the food waste and turning it into something that is useful instead of sending it to landfill. And we've seen, again, when well implemented, that this program has a lot of potential for reducing rats, because instead of the food leaking and sitting on the curb and being a mess for rats to be attracted to, it's in these nice, clean recycling bins, which then Department of Sanitation picks up with a tipper truck, so the food's never available to the rats.
What about the trash cans in the city that they're all the hard Y mesh? Can you have any say in eliminating them and having solid trash cans?
It's very expensive. So if you think about a wire mesh can, they're not expensive.
Correct.
And then you look at the steel cans that we recommend, often costing $600. You know, I know that it is a big difference for a city agency's budget. What they do is they have an adopt-a-can program. What we do is we advocate for neighbors to participate in adopt-a-can. So what we'll say is, you know, new construction.
Part of the construction.
You know, adopt-a-can. Keeping it clean is the way that you prevent rats. And so anyone bringing in new business to a neighborhood should think about what they need to do to keep the neighborhood clean.
Thank you, Carolyn, for this informative, and all the CBA viewers, May 11th, Caroline will be there personally. It's going to be a full Rat Academy program. Thank you very much, Caroline.
Thank you. Looking forward to it.
And I hope you get the success. And in a year's time, maybe we'll see you and have a chat about something else rather than rats.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Thank you very much. And we hope to have you back again. And this wraps it up for Community Board 8 Speaks. Thank you for watching, and welcome next month.